introduce to you Joe Kelly. Thank you. Thank you for giving me this opportunity to speak to you today. What does it mean to support Israel? In answering this question, I think we must first answer why Israel should be supported. First and foremost, we should say that Israel is the only true democracy in the Middle East. All of Israel's citizens get to vote. It doesn't matter if you're a Jew, Muslim, Christian, or otherwise. As well, any religious persuasion is allowed to serve in Israel's government. Even when Arab members of Knesset openly speak out against Israel, bordering on treason, many times they are tolerated. Free speech, freedom of the press, freedom of religion, freedom to demonstrate and to express oneself, these are all products of the Israeli democratic society. Why should we support Israel? Because Israel is bringing us closer towards the future. In the fields of science, medicine, and technology, Israel is leading in entrepreneurship and innovation. If you use a cell phone or have a computer with an Intel chip, thank Israel. Why should we support Israel? Because Israel is our biblical home. Last year, I had the pleasure of spending an entire month in Israel. My wife Emily and I trekked from one side of Israel to the other. It was like walking the Bible. To be able to touch the Wailing Wall as I gazed up at the sky was an experience that will always be with me. And while it is the home of Judaism, it is also the home of Christianity. Emily and I visited Jesus' synagogue and saw Mary's mikveh, or ritual bath. We stood where Jesus was crucified and where they washed the blood off of him following his death. Why should we support Israel? Because Israel is on the front lines of terror. There are two terrorist organizations which control the Palestinian territories. Hamas controls Gaza on the east part of Israel, and Fatah controls the West Bank, or more properly, Judea and Samaria. Both organizations, Hamas and Fatah, have charters calling for the destruction of Israel. Hamas states in the introduction of its charter, quote, "For our struggle against the Jews is extremely wide-ranging and grave, so much so that it will need all the loyal efforts we can wield to be followed by further steps and reinforced by successive battalions from the multifarious Arab and Islamic world until the enemies are defeated and Allah's victory prevails," end quote. While Fatah states in its charter, Article 12, quote, "The basic objectives of the Fatah movement, total liberation of Palestine and the liquidation of the Zionist entity economically, politically, militarily, and culturally," end quote. So you have two terrorist entities controlling all of the Palestinians. Hezbollah has all but taken over Lebanon. The Iranian President Mahmoud Ahmadinejad has threatened to wipe Israel off the map, possibly with nuclear weapons. And Syria continues to house the heads of Hamas and Palestinian Islamic Jihad. Israel stands in the middle of all this. Israel is a civilization in the middle of chaos, and that is why we need to support her. And now that chaos is a lot more pronounced and a lot more profound. Over the last month or so, we have turned on our television sets to see the latest rallies and or riots taking place throughout the Middle East. Beginning in Tunisia, citizens of various nations have risen up against their respective governments, which we refer to as regimes, in the quest to rid their nations of their leaders. We hear the terms freedom and democracy constantly mentioned by the media and elsewhere with regard to these revolutions. I want each and every one of you to be worried about this, because while freedom and democracy is the best we can hope for, is our ultimate goal for that area and for all areas around the globe. What is happening right now in the Middle East may be the opposite of freedom and democracy. While we hope and pray for freedom, what we may get may be much worse than the regimes in place right now. Case in point, Egypt. Hosni Mubarak was a friend to Israel, albeit a cold friend, but a friend nonetheless. At least a friend enough not to threaten war with Israel. And for us Jews, when a Middle Eastern leader doesn't threaten us with violence, we call that a friend. Was there major trade going on between the two nations, Israel and Egypt? No. Was Mubarak traveling to Israel to do photo ops with Netanyahu in Jerusalem? No. When Emily and I traveled to the border of Egypt and Israel, we asked the border guard if we could pass, and the border guard, with a concerned look, said, yes, but you do so at your own risk. So was this a real friendship? No. But when Israel invaded Gaza and Hamas was looking for weapons from Egypt, Mubarak, without worrying one bit about world opinion, closed off any access Hamas had with Egypt. You see, Israel is not worried as much about trade and about friendly relations with her neighbors as she is about security for her people. More than anything else, Israel is in the business of saving her people's lives. And because of Hosni Mubarak's actions regarding Gaza, we all, or at least all of those who support Israel, owe him our gratitude. But we may not get that chance, because today, Egypt is Mubarak free. In his place are those who wish to see him brought to justice, maybe hanged like Saddam. Who are these people? Are they students? Well, what started as a student-led revolution has quickly become Israel's worst nightmare. The New York Times, just a couple weeks ago, printed the following headline: Islamist group is rising force in New Egypt. I'm going to read to you the first paragraph. Quote, in post-revolutionary Egypt, where hope and confusion collide in the daily struggle to build a new nation, religion has emerged as a powerful political voice, following an uprising that was based on secular ideals. The Muslim Brotherhood, an Islamist group once banned by the state, is at the forefront, transformed into a tacit partner with a military government that many fear will thwart fundamental changes, end quote. The Muslim Brotherhood was founded in 1928 by a schoolteacher named Hassan al-Banna. It was created for two primary reasons. One was to rid the English and other so-called colonizers from the area. In the 1920s, England had succeeded in destroying the Ottoman Empire and in splitting apart the Middle East, creating nations that we have to this day. Fundamentalist Muslims took offense to this, as the Ottoman Empire was their caliphate, their religiously mandated Islamic kingdom. And while this brotherhood wished to rid the area of the English, they also wished to oust all those leaders whom the English put in power. And even though these leaders were Muslims themselves, they were still considered traitors to Islam. For the Brotherhood, people like Hosni Mubarak, Muammar Gaddafi, Bashar Assad, and King Abdullah of Jordan are latter-day descendants of these, quote, traitors. So today, the Brotherhood is seeing its nearly century-long dream become reality. Now, I shed no tears for people like Hosni, or people like Muammar Gaddafi and Bashar Assad. Gaddafi, in particular, has American blood on his hands for his involvement in the Flight 103 terrorist attack of 1988. However, I would much rather have the devil that I know in power in the Middle East than the devil that I don't know. Because what I do know is that the Muslim Brotherhood, if the Muslim Brotherhood takes over the Middle East, the group will seek to do the one thing that they have sought to do since 1948, and that is to destroy Israel. And Egypt, which houses the global headquarters of the Brotherhood, where the military has access to billions of dollars of American-made weaponry, including a slew of F-16 jet fighters. Stability will be in jeopardy, and Israel's life will be on the line. And again, that is why we need to support Israel. So back to the question, what constitutes support for Israel? Supporting Israel means praising Israel for her innovation and democratic ideals. Supporting Israel means embracing our biblical heritage. Israel is God's nation. And as it is written in Genesis, those who bless Israel shall be blessed, and those who curse Israel shall be cursed.
Amen.
Supporting Israel means understanding Israel's precarious situation, where she is surrounded by enemies who wish for nothing but her destruction, and educating others about this. And supporting Israel means being a voice for Israel when you know that there are so many around the world who are actively criticizing her. This last point needs some further reflection, because unfortunately, there are those within our community who pile on this criticism, who, when they see the Obama administration, an administration which is perceived to be the most anti-Israel in our nation's history, place pressure on Israel, they say, great, do more, put more pressure on. There are those within our community who call for an, quote, immediate resolution to the Israeli-Palestinian peace process, where there is no peace to be made, when the only group who is there to sit down with is Fatah, a terrorist group whose own charter calls for Israel's destruction, whose militant wing, the Al-Aqsa Martyrs Brigade, is on the U.S. State Department's list of foreign terrorist organizations. There are those within our community who call for an investigation every time the world has the smallest problem with how Israel defends herself. One of these groups calling for the exerting of pressure on Israel, calling for an immediate resolution on Palestinian statehood, and calling for investigation after investigation is represented here today. That group is J Street. But J Street has done much worse, much worse. When Israel went into Gaza in December 2008 to root out Hamas, after thousands of rockets and mortar shells had been fired on Israel from Gaza, J Street called Israel's actions, quote, disproportionate. They said it was, quote, counterproductive. The group released a statement saying that there was no difference between Israel's fighting in Gaza and Hamas suicide bombers. J Street stated, quote, neither Israelis nor Palestinians have a monopoly on right or wrong. While there is nothing right in raining rockets on Israeli families or dispatching suicide bombers, there is nothing right in punishing 1.5 million already suffering Gazans for the actions of the extremists among them, end quote. J Street calls itself pro-Israel, but never, repeat never, have I heard a pro-Israel organization say that Israel's defense of its nation was no different than the terrorists who threatened the Jewish state. The leader of the Reform Movement of Judaism, Rabbi Eric Yaffe, not really known as a shining symbol of the pro-Israel community, stated about J Street's moral equivalence, quote, these words are deeply distressing because they are morally deficient, profoundly out of touch with Jewish sentiment, and also appallingly naive, end quote. My group, Young Zionists, in August of last year, held a demonstration against J Street outside of their inaugural South Florida event. Attending J Street's event was an individual named Sofian Abdelaziz Zakout. I know about Zakout because I was instrumental in getting his Hamas-related charity, the Health Resource Center for Palestine, shut down in April of 2003. Zakout, at the time, was the vice president of the charity. The group's secretary and treasurer at the time, Syed Khor Ahmad, was the creator and webmaster of the official website of Hamas's parent organization in Gaza, the Islamic Association, or Al-Jabiya al-Islamiyya. Here's the page taken from the website of Zakout's latest group, Amana. It says, quote, please help us protect our children from the Zionist Jews, end quote. When Zakout told the J Street group who he was, they gave him a rousing round of applause. So Dr. Abraham, I don't know you personally, and I have nothing against you, but I don't know how anyone can say that the organization you represent is pro-Israel. Israel is a tiny nation amongst a sea of enemies. We need to support Israel and speak out for Israel, not act like one of Israel's enemies' surrogates. Thank you. Yeah.